Imagine you bought the latest graphics card, an RTX 3090, so you could play the latest games at the highest possible settings. These cards aren't cheap. An RTX 3090 can cost around $2,500 at current market prices. Prices are high due to the current processor shortage, as well as miners putting pressure on these prices by buying multiple GPUs. At $2,500, you would expect performance and reliability on expensive hardware like this. But in the last few months, there have been reports of these RTX 3090s failing completely, or in other words, bricked. A lot of the failures have centered around a new MMO called New World, and this has caused some debate about what caused the failure. Was it the cause of this new game with erroneous code that triggered an issue with the hardware? Or was it the case of design flaws within the hardware itself that means potentially other games could trigger the same problem? And if it is hardware, was it the fault of Nvidia, who designed the reference model of the graphics card and also approved the final design of third-party cards? In this video, I want to explore the evidence available about these RTX 3090s failing, from gaming news and hardware sites, to users who posted about their experiences on forums, to prominent YouTubers who've speculated on the failures. I also want to look at PCB designs of the RTX 3090 and 3080 to see if any answers lie there. I'll do my best to explain things in layman's terms so that as many users can appreciate the problem. Finally, as an owner of a 3090 and 3080, I want to conclude by taking all the information I've gathered and make some conclusions on what users should do next. It might seem like we're walking on eggshells, and we shouldn't have to do this given a warranty should cover these types of problems. But feel free to take or not take the advice in this video in any way that suits your gaming needs. And until we have more definitive information, much of the info here is speculation. If you like the video, hit the like button, subscribe for more videos like this, and we have a Discord server, so come along and join us there, and I'll leave a link in the description below. Back in July, a new MMO made by Amazon Games came onto the scene. As with many online games these days, this had a beta period where gamers could try out the game, while developers could stress test and bug test their game on a wider scale. Users began reporting their games crashing. But most notably, a small number of users reported their graphics card failing and not turning on again. Of this group of users, RTX 3090 made up the most number of graphics cards, and a high proportion of this were EVGA RTX 3090 cards. Other brands also failed, but it seemed that EVGA were the most prominent. This article back in July from PC Magazine says that playing Amazon's New World MMO is bricking RTX 3090 graphics cards. It also appears that EVGA were also significantly affected, given they've been the only company that has responded as to why their 3090s were failing. A Reddit post with over 1,600 comments and 1,200 upvotes had users post about their own 3090s failing. Looking through all the comments, it does seem like there are some similarities between users. Many of these users were indeed EVGA RTX 3090 For the Win 3 owners playing New World and reported that just changing graphics settings killed the game, with the graphics card giving black screens and the PC shutting down. Was this the cause of New World specifically, or was this the fault of the hardware? Jayz Two Cents, a prominent YouTuber who has been following the issue since it occurred, made a video recently noting some problems when testing New World. He noted that the menu used significantly high power draw, using over 400 watts at one stage on his EVGA 3090 For the Win 3 card. The high amount of power isn't unusual, as it's a rendered scene, but it could be that switching between graphics settings may cause power surges. Jay also suggested that sudden power surges could cause stress on graphics card components. Another issue Jay discovered was that different cards behave differently, though this may not be endemic to New World alone. He noted that with the EVGA RTX 3090 For the Win 3, when he adjusted the power limit through MSI Afterburner, New World didn't follow with the same power limit, instead sometimes drawing more power. Here, he requested 107% of the power limit, but the game draws 115% of the power limit, hitting 400 watts. With another card he tested, the MSI Gaming X Trio, this did not have the same problem. It could be that the EVGA card didn't work well with MSI Afterburner, or with New World in particular it caused problems, but in general, MSI Afterburner is the most widely used GPU overclocking utility and works with the majority of graphics cards. As Jay said, these could be pieces of the puzzle why the EVGA cards might be failing. Some users on forums have said it could be a problem with the EVGA BIOS that was used on Jay's card and that it may be buggy. Nevertheless, drawing 400 watts is particularly high, that could cause problems with lower quality GPUs. A poster on Reddit had another theory about why high-end graphics cards could be failing. The user Falkentine speculated that some of the VRMs, the voltage regulator modules, could have been overloaded and as a result failed. For this, I'd like to give a brief explanation of how graphics cards work. As a disclaimer, I'm not an electrical or hardware engineer, but I'll try to explain as best as I can. If you have any questions, make sure to comment below and check the links to resources I've used for this video in the description. First, we'll need to understand the basic electrical fundamentals. One key law of electricity that you may remember from school is P equals V times I. V is the voltage measured in volts. This is a measure of the speed of the electrons in the electricity. I is the current measured in amps. This is the measure of the number of electrons in the electricity. Think of this as the amount of electricity. P is the amount of power measured in watts. This is how much power is delivered. An RTX 3090 Founders Edition from NVIDIA has a TDP or a total draw power of 350 watts. Other cards don't use as much power. An RTX 3080 has a TDP of 320 watts. An RTX 3070 has a TDP of 230 watts. There are also custom third-party cards that have higher TDPs. An ASUS RTX 3090 Strix can use 480 watts. This is the PCB or printed circuit board of the RTX 3090 Founders Edition. The GPU core is located in the center and this renders your graphics. The memory chips surround the GPU core. Placing them close to the GPU core allows as efficient access to data as possible. The power comes through the 12-pin connectors and PCIe slot on the Founders Edition through the VRMs, which include the PWM, the pulse width modulator, then through the MOSFETs or power stages, the inductors also known as chokes, and then the capacitors to deliver clean, smooth power to the GPU core and memory. A modern power supply supplies 12 volts of power to the motherboard and graphics card. However, CPUs and GPUs are sensitive and can't withstand that kind of voltage. That's where the VRM comes into the picture. It steps down the incoming 12 volt power supply to 1.1 volts on average and sends it over to the CPU or GPU core and memory. The VRMs are a key aspect of the graphics card. The VRMs consist of multiple components and are as follows. First, the PWM determines the number of power phases used by the graphics card. This usually matches the number of power stages or MOSFETs on the card. For example, if you have an 8-phase PWM controller, a good match would be 8 power stages. On the Founders Edition, the number of power stages seems to match up well with the number of phases on the controller. However, as you'll see later on, some third-party NVIDIA graphics cards can have a different number of power stages to phases. A typical PWM signal has consistent highs and lows. Having more phases is considered better, as this means the VRM is off for a longer period of time, and thus cooler. On a 3-phase system, a set of VRMs is on for 33% of the time, but on a 4-phase system, the VRM would be on 25% of the time. The power stages, or MOSFETs, determines when to send power through to the inductor, acting a bit like a gate. The inductor filters as power. A typical PWM signal can be 300 kHz, and the inductor will turn this into 60 Hz, which is more usable for the GPU core. Capacitors store the energy and release the right amount to the GPU core as needed. Any excess energy in the circuit gets released to ground. So to recap, the 12 volt power comes through the power connectors and PCIe slot, where PWMs controls the number of phases, which then gets sent to each of the MOSFETs, inductors, and capacitors, which filters and stores the power and delivers it to the GPU core. Now that we've covered the theory, let's get back to what Falkentine speculated. I'll leave a link below for the Reddit thread, but in a nutshell, Falkentine suggested that given Nvidia had split off the VRMs into two groups, that one group of VRMs may have had an excessively high amount of current, but because the overall TDP of the card was not excessively high, the graphics card did not throttle down. For the RTX 3090 and 3080 models, Nvidia has designed the boards with NVDD and MSVDD VRMs. These are Nvidia names, so no one really knows what they stand for, but NVDD VRMs serve the main GPU core, while the MSVDD, possibly named as miscellaneous, serves other parts of the GPU die, which may include the cache, memory controllers, and display controllers. The part in red, FBVDDQ, is the memory VRMs that serve the memory chips, and the PEX-VDD serves the PCIe slot. Falkentine speculated that either the MSVDD or NVDD power could be very high and the other one low, while the card could seem like it was behaving with normal total power draw. If that's the case, very high amounts of current could be going through one set of VRMs. The VRMs are rated for a specific amount of current they can handle. Better VRMs handle higher amounts of current. In this chart from O Technology, they've gathered information on the current limits of the VRMs. The MSI Gaming X Trio has the lowest amount of power stages and current limit, with 10 power stages for NVDD and 4 for MSVDD. Theoretically, this would still mean it could handle 450 amps through NVDD. The Nvidia's Founders Edition has the highest rated VRMs at 70 amp power stages, meaning a total of 700 amps through NVDD, useful for overclockers who want to use as much power as possible. One thing I briefly mentioned is power usage spikes. While most software utilities like HWinfo or GPUZ do a good job of monitoring a wide variety of information, special purpose equipment like an oscilloscope can measure power signals at a much finer level. Here, Igors Lab measured a Founders Edition 3090 and found that the total load could have spikes up to 450 watts, even though on average the reading would be 360 watts. Zooming in even closer into 10 microseconds per interval shows even higher spikes above 500 watts. On the Founders Edition, it may be acceptable given the 70 amp power stages. However, on the MSI Gaming X Trio with 45 amp power stages, this has a lot less safety factor built in. Getting back to the EVGA RTX 3090 for the Win 3, it's unknown if uneven loading was a factor. This card has 13 50 amp power stages for NVDD alone, so in terms of loading, 650 amps should be more than capable to handle loads. So in my opinion, it's possible, but I would expect more MSI Gaming X Trio cards failing if that were the case. The For the Win 3 card has 3 8-pin connectors, with each one capable of drawing 150 watts. Other lower-end RTX 3090s have 2 8-pin connectors, so the For the Win 3 card does have the potential to draw higher amounts of power. EVGA has made an official statement and attributed the issue to poor soldering. While technically this does make sense, it's still worth investigating if there are design flaws. The actually hardcore overclocking channel run by Buildzoid also investigated the issue. In his video probing a Gigabyte RTX 3090 Vision that died when trying to run New World, Buildzoid probed a dead RTX 3090 Vision to see what component died. On this particular card, an input safety fuse tripped due to the large load, and one of the NVDD power stages died. Buildzoid noted that while he would repair the card and the card would be usable again, there's every chance that in the same scenario, playing New World or any game that would trigger the same circumstances, it's possible the card could die again. But Buildzoid stopped short of saying it was a design flaw, commenting that he would need to test multiple cards to see if the issue was repeatable. Buildzoid also commented on the asymmetrical VRM design on these cards. On many of the RTX 3090 and 3080 cards, there were more power stages than power phases. For example, when a PWM with 8 power phases powers 10 power stages, it's possible that the PWM controller may at times fail to deal with the asymmetrical VRM. There really isn't much anyone can do about this except purchase a graphics card with the highest reliability rate. Cards like Founders Edition or the ASUS Strix have generally had less problems. Let's conclude by summarizing what we know to help RTX 3090 and 3080 owners who want to take precaution with their hardware. Again, if this sounds like we shouldn't have to babysit the card, you're absolutely right. So if you don't wish to follow this, that's perfectly fine, and it's your hardware. But for those who want to, here are my thoughts on this. Number one, it's possible New World can create power spikes which would let through large amounts of current and potentially damage the VRM. In my opinion, this isn't something endemic to New World. Many games have power spikes, and it's very possible other games could cause the same problems. Number two, one way to reduce graphics cards dying would be to undervolt your GPU to lower the power draw, which would also lower spikes. Capping your frame rate to 60fps would also reduce and smooth power draw as well. Number three, some graphics cards may have issues with MSI Afterburner in some games. In Jay's video, 107% of the TDB translated to 400 watts is actually 115%. In this case, it's probably a good idea to monitor the TDP in case it gets too high. An undervolt of 15% to 300 watts would be pretty safe in my opinion, and that should give a bit of room for power spikes. Number four, if you have to undervolt the 3090, it's a bit pointless to buy it when it's going to be pretty close in performance to the RTX 3080. If you don't need the extra VRAM, I'd recommend a 3080 over a 3090. When it comes to the design of the cards, it could be a range of issues. Number one, it could be a soldering issue, in which case it would be a complete luck of the draw. Number two, it could be one set of VRMs getting overused over another, in which case you wouldn't have much control over that, and you'd best wait for a driver that would mitigate issues like that occurring. Number three, or it could be a problem with asymmetrical VRMs, which exist in pretty much all the 3090s, in which case, if you still wanted to buy one, you should go with the most reliable models like a Founders Edition or an ASUS Strix that have a lower failure rate. While there isn't a definitive answer right now as to what happened, you can take at least some precautions for your hardware. That's going to be it for this one. If you like this video, make sure to hit the like button, subscribe, and I'll see you guys in the next one.